Welcome back to Let's Play Cyberpunk 2077 Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. I did check my video last episode. I did park the bike there, so either it's a bug that it's not here anymore, or people do just steal it back. I think it's not really mine anyway. So what are we doing today? Next episode I'm hoping will be finally with my RTX 3060. I have it. I just need an adapter from my 6-pin connectors on my power supply to the actual 8-pin connector on the card itself, which I did not know was like that. So that should be coming tomorrow. I'm not beating on the brat yet. Oops. What happened? I clicked something. Something clicked. There's reported crime all the way over here. Assault in progress over here. These are moderate. Side job here. Maybe I'll hit this and this. What is that, fixer? Is that? Not meeting Takamura yet. Sergey. Okay. Don't walk. But I want to walk. I just took my motorcycle, so now I'm running. Well, he took someone's motorcycle. One side. Don't walk.
Wanna make a good enough? Start your ascent with a penthouse in Charger Hill.
Who knows what you might find? Okay, I'm going. Yeah, this way. Running, 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 running. They both head this way. Yeah. We're getting closer. I almost feel like running this time instead of calling Jackie's bike, and I kinda want Jackie's bike to last a little while. And every time I use it, it tends to be not good for the health of the vehicle. Oh, there is us. Oh, I got. We got people we don't like over here. Or people that don't like us. Robots. ONCPD. Alright, let's stay clear of these guys. We won't be messing with them.
Our house contains easy beef, deep beef culture.
I understand completely. Can I go this way? Oh wow. And here we've got a crime in progress over here. down there, actually. Can I get down there easily from here? Marmor Bank. Maybe we can get down this way. Yeah, I stopped looking at the map. Yeah, we can't get down this way. Oh, convenient stairs. To battle? To battle. Racketeer. You didn't like that, did ya? She did. That's the one that... Yeah, oh crap!
What's with you guys?
Yeah, how dare they die like that, right? That's it? That was easy. I thought there was more of them than that. Okay. Multi-layered Kazan Exo-Jacks with anti-shrapnel lining. That's a little over the top. Colorado Beetle Aramid Reinforced Helmet. Just what I wanted. On my Christmas wish list. Oh. Archive conversation with unknown and Isao Suzuki. Unknown says, got eyes on O'Brien, sending my Luke. Suzuki says, stay there. Don't let him out of your sight. Sure, having dinner with the wife and kid. Probably be there a while. Is that Mrs. Unknown and Unknown Jr.? Suzuki says, alright, our teams will be there in a second. Unknown says, when do I get the Eds? Promised me. Suzuki says, since when do snitching losers get paid? Huh? Since when? But I helped you. There was supposed to be a reward. But okay, I don't need it. I don't want any trouble. Suzuki says, I'm screwing with you, Chum. You'll get the Eds, don't worry. Haha, sorry. Totally got me. Yeah. Oh wow. Spontaneous combustion. Alright, I gotta break it on down over here. Is there a machine over here? I kinda feel like... Got my cred! Just had to kill him completely. That looks a lot like my bike, except mine didn't have arch on it. It was a different seat, actually. As well. I think it's the same color, though. Well, what do we got here? Momentum carbon reinforced visored helmet, tacticloth cargo pants, and an archive conversation with Ken Okan MI. Readable. Con MI says, got a hit for you. Olivier O'Brien. Guy's a guard in a Militech prison. Protects Biggs. That, now in all caps, that snitching little me who scoot over our boys, and you know what to do with snitches and bitches, who protect them. Anyway, Olivier goes, Biggs loses protection and his spot in solitary. Then Bradley Costigan, our inside Choom, gets his hands on him. Simple? Better be. Small world, huh? Bradley Costigan just rescued his wife last episode. They are holding his wife for ransom, or for him to turn himself into them or something. Small world. This goes down into the water? I think it does. Yep. I'm in the water. What's this? Bloop, 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 bloop. $99 Look, I can't get up. I need to get on this ladder. Thank you very much. I couldn't go that way. Ah, that was refreshing. Checking something. Okay. I want to see if we reset it back to 100. Just those eddies there. Alright, well that's one down. Oh, this person's still alive. Get more street cred if you kill them all the way. Kill them all the way. Anything around me? Kind of food junk shop. Buy and sell almost anything. Okay. Drop point. Alright, let's go there into the junk shop. Oh wait, I need a spike. Oh, there's somebody. Hold up. Oh, whoa, what the hell? I just wanted to get off of it. Sad. Oh. Whoops! Alright, that was way too much. He's not supposed to race forward like that. Be crowded around here. Oh, it's close by. Oh, sorry guys. It's down there. Can I just jump down there? Rather than go all the way. Yeah, the junk shop's there. Will I die? Well, this is glass. I can try, can I? It is glass. This is pod, right? I thought it said poo. Ish poo. Get stinky poo. Wow. Oh, well, there's stairs. I'd be like a normal person, just take the stairs and walk. But we can't do that. No, look. Now we got people who appear from out of nowhere. That's new, for me, at least, for the latest patch.
I'm glad you could clear your schedule.
Clear my schedule? Mind if I peruse? Where'd you find this stuff?
Where's all this stuff come from?
Trade secret.
I think I've been here.
You gonna get anything? Because otherwise you just take it off.
I have been here. This is where we bought the... I'll be right back. This is where we bought Johnny Silverhand's. As you can see, Silverhand there. He bought his record for him. Records. Or one record. Save. Okay. I am going to buy and sell stuff. I'll be right back. Okay. It didn't last very long. She ran out of money. Must have a drop point somewhere around here. Close by. Maybe I can sell a few more things. Another junk shop there. Yeah. Bunch of junk shops around here. One side. Oh, hey, I take this stuff. Oh, that's a ripper dock. So we have to go up to get to this? Yeah, up even more, it looks like. Yeah, I'm bent. She said get bent. I'm not sure. Alright, so I sold my guns and melee weapons that I didn't need. Actually, she couldn't take. Everything. Tire iron. Yeah, the tire iron's better for non-lethal. It's a rare iconic, that's why. But this one is, better DPS. That's rare as well. Sold that one. I'm gonna go through all these clothes, I'll be back. Okay. Now just gonna go over what we have. Actually... let me just go like this. Yeah, for the head, what's the best? We have... I guess. Yeah, I don't... I'm getting tired of the... the head. I think you move A and D? Or Q and E, okay. I'm getting tired of the hair like that. I guess. I guess I'll just go like this for now. Not too crazy about it, but it is the best headgear I have right now. And then for the upper body, yeah. When I get to level 30, it's gonna be a while. So we're still wearing this. These are mods. Am I really that into it to have a mod on it? It has mods on it already. Okay. Now, we got a frayed scav combat suit for 87.2 armor. That looks the same. Wait, military. Wait. I can't put this on, frayed scav combat suit. Oh, okay, I have it on. It doesn't look any different, though. Let me just... Okay, it doesn't look different. But I guess that's fine as long as I actually have the armor. Just want to look at these. I was wearing this, right? It's not changing. It won't stay. Look at that. It won't stick. Weird. Okay. And then for this, yeah, I have to be level 20. Well, we're coming up on it. I can wear these Silver Star dual layer, etc. And I have to get better shoes. Oh no, this requires 32. Okay. So let me sell these few things. I wanted to see what the tank top looked like. I'm keeping this hazmat suit just for in case I need it for anything. Equipped. Okay. Look at us at 151 weight. Sweet. Alright, save that in. And then I want to go... There's a side job there, but I also want to go there. I know the side job's kind of on the way, isn't it? They want me to go... Where exactly? They want me to go up, I think. That's the combat music. This one's this way. Combat music stop. Wait, you want me to cross the road? I think. Oh, you want me to be on the other side of the road? To be on the right track now. Both are up this way. This continues this way. Thank you. She was holding up that car so I could cross. Pack of Morleys, huh? Most frequently seen sports car in Night City. Somehow I don't think our indicators are from that. Tyger Claws. He's unarmed though. Yeah. Huh. Huh, they're on alert. They spotted me, but... Are they gonna help their friends out here? Are these more Tyger Claws? They sure are. It looks very familiar. Like I've had a fight in this exact same space over here. Glitch him. Actually. Who's that? That's a max tag raider. Don't shoot him. Oh wait. Doing something doing something illegal. I can't defend myself? We are in the combat. I am being the hit. That guy's just sitting there. Ow. I'm not doing anything illegal now. Just don't hit that guy, I guess. I don't want to hit the max tack guy. The max tack guy just sits there. He just stands there and lets the stuff go on. Archive conversation with Osamu Gosho and Hideo Nishio. Let's read that. Osamu Gosho says, Hideo, I need you to go herd some pigs. Remind them where their turf ends and ours begins. Sure thing. Osamu says, Redwood. Hideo says, got it. Redwood? Is that the street or something? Hi. Chemically hardened goggles of some kind. I don't want to get too close to this guy. I intend to just start shooting. Ha! Ah, a cute little scooter. Can we ride this? No, it doesn't look like we can. Ah, how sad. I have to get over here and take this thing. Alright. Are we getting a little close to you? I don't exactly want to, but... I want to complete... What's going on here? Archive patrol. I leveled up! I can wear those pants now. Wait. That's not Z. That's not... Give me the Z. The Z... Ah, I missed it. Archive patrol. NCPD dispatch says, calling all units in Westbrook. I repeat, calling all units in Westbrook. Sergeant Max Smith says, 2891 reporting 1020 Westbrook. That means arrived on scene, 1020, I believe. NCPD dispatch says, head to Redwood Street, that's what Redwood means, in Japantown. Order to increase our presence in the area. Coming from the chief. Sergeant Max Smith says, Japantown? Alone? Requesting additional units for backup. Request denied. Sergeant says, this some pre-election stunt? That's Tyger turf. Dispatch says, are you refusing to comply? 2891, come in and respond. Sergeant says negative. Order accepted. We'll comply. Effing chief. Dispatch says 2891. Say again. Sergeant says nothing. Nothing. Copy that. Wow, we gotta level up. Level. That's crafting. Alright, so I want to get better. I want to get stealthy. We're getting pretty good at stealthy. Sometimes people don't even see us when I'm like not far from them and not even sneaking. So I'm gonna put another into cool. I like that. Anything else we can do with stealth? The red ones. Detection time is increased by 20%. Okay. So 20% more time for them I have until they detect me. That's gonna be pretty noticeable, I think. Entering combat, crit chance increases by 25% for 7 seconds. Moving speed after successful takedown. So nice, I don't do Hidden Dragon. Sounds sweet, but later. Quick melee attacks with ranged weapons, stagger enemies. Daggers. Can pick up an enemy's body immediately after performing a takedown by holding E. Immunity to poison. I'm gonna take this detection time increased. Cool. Literally. Literally cool. Yay. So next we got the this side job here. And we've got a reported crime here as well. Ooh, look at that. Very high over there. Cross the bridge. There's danger. Let me go in here yet. Is this bar? Oh. Cyber Psycho. Yeah. I want to get to these Cyber Psychos soon. Danger very low. This one too. We got all this stuff out here in the outskirts. Look at that. There's not much out there, is there? So I might be headed up that way next to take care of these cyber psychos. Yeah, they got a few very low things. And then we'll be back to the main quest again. Moderate, yeah. Low. Moderate. There's a bunch of stuff. There's always a bunch of stuff. I like clearing out the map, though. It's satisfying. So since we're only 32 minutes, I would call in an episode here, but if you guys want to tune out, absolutely can. But I'm just going to hang out. I can't actually sit here. I kind of want to get away from that guy anyway. Max TAC officer. Depend. I'm sitting here on the steps, and I'm going to be reading for a little bit. Let's, because we've gotten some shards here that we haven't read, so I'm going to read through them, and that'll be the rest of the episode. So if you guys don't want to hear it, you can tune out now. If not, just keep watching or listening. Arasaka and ornithology: three Japanese words to know. Including the word end. As conversations over factionalism within Arasaka heat up, many industry insiders wonder about the company's future trajectory. If you struggle to understand the complicated inner machinations of the world's largest arms manufacturer, look no further than the obscure science of ornithology. Yes, that's right. The study of birds can help. At least, in a sense. There are three Japanese words every corporate player ought to be familiar with. Kiji, Hato, and Taka. Oh, I thought the three words were Arasaka and ornithology. Kiji, green pheasant. This bird has long held cultural and symbolic significance in Japan. One can admire the world's last living specimens at Hanako Arasaka's private preserve on the island of Shikoku. But the word Kiji also bears meaning among the factional identities within Arasaka. This group, with Hanako at its center, that's the daughter of the emperor or whatever there, or the head of the company, consists primarily of conservative technocrats who wish to follow the course set by Saburo Arasaka himself. That's a guy. In his daughter, Hanako, they see a guiding force to maintain the old order and stability within the corporation. Hato, dove. The symbolism of the dove is recognized far and wide. The symbol also aptly captures the character of the much smaller faction within the company led by Michiko Arasaka, daughter of the late Kei and niece to Hanako. There's an asterisk there. This liberal wing of the corporation has unified those who seek deeper reforms. Although they currently hold little influence, they enjoy growing support, popularity, among some politicians and media personalities. Okay, the asterisk says you can learn more about Arasaka family genealogy from the 8-book series, Two Centuries in the Clover's Shadow, available in stores soon. Taka, hawk. As symbolic as the dove is, so too is the hawk. This faction, headed by Yorinobu Arasaka, often prefers to take the most direct and uncompromising solutions. Both stubborn and temperamental, he resembles Saburo, which has given him wide support among the more militant-minded Arasaka Corp elite. However, his more pro-Western inclinations and ideas that are innovative, as they are controversial, have weakened his support from the board's loyal traditionalist. Okay. A wicked acid trip, but not the kind you think. Ever wonder what it feels like to fall in a pool of acid? Well, wonder no more, sort of. I'd rather not feel that. Before I ever got my copy of Kings of Acid, my curiosity took a nosedive once I found out it wasn't about that type of acid. In any case, body horror has such a rich tradition, it's a damn near Herculean task to find a fresh angle to take on acid paths. But holy crap, did the devs do it. You play as Arthur Kerr, a klutzy and somewhat awkward rocker boy who gets himself tangled up in a bleep strum. Should it be storm? With Maelstrom. The Borg goons entrust Kerr with holding a mysterious shipment containing a protozoa capable of instantaneous regeneration. But in an unlucky twist, a painfully common occurrence for our hero, a rival gang ambushes the exchange at a corp science lab and Kerr is pushed into a vat of mutagenic acid. That's when the trip kicks in, if you will. The rocker boy begins undergoing constant mutations, eyeballs on stalks, shifting skin, throat tentacles, and that's not even the real freaky stuff. Oh my god. After every victory in combat, Ortur absorbs the genetic code from the blood splatter of his foes, making the already delightful hack-and-slash combat even more gratifying. The constantly growing spiral of possible mutations makes for a rewarding way to spend experience points and builds in strong replayability. Yeah, this is a game. Yeah. All in all, Kerr's ultimate motivation is seeking bloody revenge against his music producer who cost him a lucrative album deal and brutally murdered the rocker boy's boyfriend. Story and gameplay are geniusly intertwined, and the pseudo-brain dance implant shipped with each game copy helps immerse players in the utterly screwed mutations where searing pain turns to power-jacked ecstasy. Trust me, you don't want to miss out on this one. I think I might want to miss out on that one. Another world. Dubai. Sand and death. I heard a troubling click. My Geiger counter. May it rest in peace. I stood on a glass surface, some parts smooth as ice, others cracked and jagged. The earth I walked on was formed from melted sand after a thermonuclear bomb detonated here, one of the 5 that fell on Dubai. I recalled old stills from the end of the 20th century. Skyscrapers like crystal obelisks touching the sky, supercars, palm trees, now nothing. Like a surreal frozen sea blanketed by the irradiated dust of the Arabian Peninsula and glinting under the desert sun. But nearby, in the city's former suburbs, life continues on. Difficult, brutal, cutthroat, but life nonetheless. Few dare venture outside without a hazmat suit, makeshift or otherwise. Any sort of dwelling must be built with concrete walls measuring at least 13 feet thick, and without a single window. This offers survival, yes, but to what end? Unlike in the corporate haven of New Dubai, erected deeper into the Arabian Gulf, the average life expectancy in old Dubai is a mere 30 years. Still, some have found advantages to life there. No visitors, neither Net Watch nor any corporate special forces unit will deploy here. This land of glass and dust has become asylum for some of the world's most wanted criminals. Some say they're only biding their time until an early death delivers them to hell. Some say they're already there. Wow. That's for real, yeah. It's not under fiction or anything. Outer space, my life in orbit. What's life in space like? Comfortable. Of course, not everything's a bed of roses. Gravity below 1G isn't great for your bones or muscles. Synthesized food isn't to die for, and stuff from Earth is as rare as it is expensive. If you live in a private orbital station, congrats, you're richer than me, you always see the same faces. But if you live in a hybrid station like Crystal Palace, you'll have to live with corporate bachelor parties every weekend. But don't let that put you off. There are more upsides than downsides to living in orbit. First of all, safety. To get into orbit, you need a lot of zeros in your bank account, which means you won't see legions of homeless people, skezzed-out gangsters, or aggressive joy toys, the exception to that being the lunar colonies, but no self-respecting orbital dweller would ever set foot there. In other words, you can walk outside at night unarmed without security and come back home in one piece, wallet undisturbed. Amazing, right? It's because you're alone there. Secondly, quality of service. Anyone in the customer service sector had to rack up an enormous debt to come here. They only hope to pay it off within their lifetimes. Or their only hope to pay it off within their lifetimes is to rake in a lot. And I mean a lot of tips. Oh, there are other people there. Which means they'll bend over backwards to satisfy every whim. If you're an employer, you don't have to worry that an employee just hired and trained at your expense will suddenly quit and go work for the competition for a few extra eddies a week. Many stations, especially the private ones, simply don't have competition, and if they do, it's basically negligible. Agreements can be made so situations like that don't occur. Thirdly, and most importantly, no government can tell you what to do, where, and how. Orbital stations are autonomous and governed by their own laws, and there aren't that many of them. If you can afford your own station, you're the undisputed lord and master of your little corner of space. You want to tie up the help to a whipping post when they make a mistake? Go right ahead. Want 5 wives or 4 husbands? I'm sure you'll have a line of willing volunteers. Really? Thornton. Owner's Manual. Congratulations, you are now the proud owner of a Thornton. What is that? We are proud to offer our Thornton guarantee for reliability and convenience at an affordable price. Before you embark on a new adventure behind the wheel of your new Thornton, please take the time to read this owner's manual. So it's a vehicle of some kind. Table of contents. 1. Instruments and indicators. 2. Anti-theft system. 3. Seats, seatbelts, and rearview mirrors. 4. Lights and warning lights. 5. Starter, transmission, and brakes. 6. Ventilation, heating, and AC. 7. Engine and driving tips. 8. What to do in emergency. 9. Maintenance and care. 10. Service and warranty information. Okay. America. A prophecy. The terror answered. Spelled wrong. I am Orc, wreathed round the accursed tree. The times are ended, shadows pass, the morning gins to break. The fiery joy that your reason perverted to 10 commands. What night he led the starry hosts through the wild wilderness, the wide wilderness? That stony law I stamp to dust and scatter religion abroad, to the four winds as a torn book, and none shall gather the leaves, but They shall rot on desert sands and consume in bottomless deeps, to make the deserts blossom and the deeps shrink to their fountains, and to renew the fiery joy and burst the stony roof, that pale religious lechery seeking virginity may find it in a harlot, and in coarse-clad honesty, the underfilled, though ravished, in her cradle night and morn. For everything that lives is holy, life delights in life, because the soul of sweet delight can never be defiled. Fires enwrap the earthly globe, yet man is not consumed. Amidst the lustful fires he walks, his feet become like brass, his knees and thighs like silver, and his breast and head like gold. I'm not sure what that all has to... the meaning of this. The world as will and idea. But besides all this, death is the great opportunity to no longer be I, to him who uses it. During life, the will of man is without freedom. His action takes place with necessity upon the basis of his unalterable character in the chain of motives. But everyone remembers much that he has done, and an account of which he is by no means satisfied with himself. If now he were to go on living, he would go on acting in the same way, on account of the unalterable nature of his character. Accordingly, he must cease to be what he is in order to arise out of the germ of his nature as a new and different being. Therefore, death looses these bounds. The will again becomes free, for freedom lies not in the esse, but in the operare. Arthur Schopenhauer. Okay, it's very philosophical. The Iliad. I've read this. By Homer. Is this really the text from the Iliad? I mean, I haven't read it, like, 20 years. For my mother, the goddess, silver-footed Thetis, telleth me that twofold fates are bearing me toward the doom of death. If I abide here and war about the city of the Trojans, then lost is my home return, but my renown shall be imperishable. But if I return home to my dear native land, lost then is my glorious renown. Yet shall my life long endure, neither shall the doom of death come soon upon me. Aye, and I would counsel you others also to sail back to your homes, seeing there is no more hope that ye shall win the goal of steep Ilias. Homer. I've read it. I did prefer the Odyssey more. Alright, let's just collapse here. Notes. Okay. We've got a few more. Might as well just finish them up. Next episode will hopefully be with the next new graphics card, so this will look the same, so might as well read this with the old graphics card. Bushido and Neo-Postmodernism. The Bushido franchise is a litmus test of our time. This groundbreaking film series puts on full display the entire spectrum of American society, masterfully pointing out the greatest problems of the neo-modern era. Live Fast, Die Never was, in its own way, a generational manifesto on the affirmation of life. The use of vivid colors, shaky cinematography, ubiquitous blood effects, and pervasive brain splatter testifies to the extraordinary self-awareness of the director, who once revealed in an interview how he effing loves it when hot chicks dissect the crap out of the bad guys. Perhaps no other concept more aptly describes the underlying societal ethos when Bushido 3 was released. Especially worthy of note is the repetition in subsequent installments of the implant bomb motif, though the prism of which the protagonist reinterprets reality. One example of this convention's flawless implementation appears in the latest film in the series, Bushido X, Fade to Black. The scene in which the powerful Guerrera disembodies the arm of Jake, as played by the transcendent Tim Kelly, demonstrates in brilliant form the duality of the human condition. On the one hand, Jake loses his cybernetic arm, a symbol of both his tragic past and the ongoing techno-ontological conflict within his psyche. On the other hand, it is precisely due to this dismemberment that Guerrera is blown to bloody bits by a sensational explosion sequence, and the final disintegration of the antagonist's body into a blood spray of gore How should this be interpreted? Really, you're gonna find philosophy in gore and blood? It is a metaphorical cry of deeply rooted despair, a manifestation of the personal transgression. This fragmentation of body could likewise be interpreted as a fragmentation of the individual mind, thus provoking the question, whose mind? Indeed, had everything the viewer seen of Jake's struggle been in fact a personified embodied fear? Had he not been embroiled in epic battle with a vile monster, but rather only with himself? Could the entirety of Jake's narrative been only a manifestation of some cyber-psychotic dream state? Among all the depth and nuance that has defined this franchise since its inception, only one thing is truly certain. Bushido has forever changed the world of cinema. Okay. Literature. We got three more. Sayonara Station by Luke Steelman. Wait a second. Before we start, have you wondered how this book ended up in your hands? Where it came from? Who delivered it? Of course you haven't. Nobody ever wonders about things like that. It's a shame, because the answer is quite interesting. I'd go as far to say it's bleeping fascinating. Not so long ago, most shipments were made via sea on freighters, cheap, quick, and relatively safe. But during the Fourth Corporate War, some genius in Arasaka had an idea to release automated, self-replicating mines controlled by an AI into the ocean. What could possibly go wrong? A lot, it turns out. The AI had a single objective. Destroy enemy vessels. Simple, right? Nusa Militech ships would get blown out of the water, while the Arasaka Free State ships would sail by untouched, except for the AI's ironclad logic. Since there was a non-zero probability that a vessel waving a friendly flag might also have enemies on board, in the interest of optimization, it would also be sunk. Yeah, that inevitably happens. Of course, when the leadheads back at Arasaka HQ realized what they'd done, they rushed to update the software, only for the AI to reject it as a virus. And thus, because of a handful of individuals' complete lack of imagination and foresight, the history of maritime travel came to an end, really. So let's come back to the question. How'd you end up with this book? Unless you live in Chicago, where it was published, then surely not via the net, since that was destroyed by Bart Moss. Was it? Maybe it was shipped by plane, but air freight is incredibly expensive, so most likely not. By car, then? You can't rule it out. But if I had to bet on it, I'd say it came to your city via train. Imagine that trains, that's right, the ones that go choo-choo, have survived into the present day. Just last year, 15,526 miles of new train tracks were put into use, including the underground tunnel connecting Tokyo with Shanghai. At top speed, an armored train can complete the distance between the two cities in under 5 hours. Now that's something I had to experience for myself. 2 days later, I was in Tokyo, standing on the platform of Sayonara Station. Now this is literature, meaning fiction, so it might be the boats can still travel, because that's crazy. Crime block. McCrane scanned the room with a deft Kuroshi sweep. This corpse was no different than the others he'd seen over the years. The dead man's eyes frozen in fear, his ligaments, wires, and intestines strewn about the floor. None of it made any impact on McCrane anymore. I've lived too long, he thought, and cops who don't die quick usually find themselves playing for the other side eventually. This case is as clear as a used napkin at Deputy Zoo's, he murmured to Junior Inspector Malinowski. Cyberpsycho came in through the window. Victim led him inside. Must have known each other. Prints a roll over the glass. Holy crap, Malinowski shook his head in disbelief. How'd the beep get all the way up to the 11th floor? See those grooves on the windowsill? Climbing spikes. Implants these days are getting installed to pull stupid rooftop stunts, get cheap thrills. Malinowski made his way over to the window to examine the evidence his superior had so effortlessly pieced together. The veteran detective lit a cigarette and stared into the corpse's lifeless eyes. Although McCrane had never seen this man before, he felt as if he had known him a long time, and still he felt nothing for him. No pity, no compassion. This was only a body now, no longer a person. Suddenly, Malinowski's unsteady voice woke McCrane from his thoughts. Boss? These prints on the outside of the window, they belong to you. McCrane let out a quick, punctuating chuckle. Never much took you for a jokester, Malinowski, the detective said with an amused smirk as he rolled up his sleeves to expose his wrists. And I wonder, just how would I get there without any climber's claws, But before the junior inspector could respond, McCrane felt an uneasiness shoot up his spine. This room, this man, the smell of his blood. He felt compelled to walk over to the savage victim and reach inside his pocket. A photo, his own face staring back at him. Malinowski slowly drew his pistol. I believed in you, the shaken protege uttered with a pain in his voice. All this time, I idolized a murderer. I don't understand, muttered McCrane, scarcely loud enough to hear his own voice. Something else began to drown out his words, even his thoughts, a strange primal force. For the first time in my life, I don't understand. And then, crack, a gunshot. I'm going to keep reading. Is that the end? What's his name? Malinowski shot him. Okay, rewiring synaptic pathways. I read this. This will be the end. Long episode. Chapter 1, The Future of Neurotechnology. The 21st century heralded a worldwide revolution in neurotechnology. We, as a society, can no longer image an existence without technologically heightened senses, enhanced memory capacity, and pain modulators. By linking our neural systems with computer chips, we are capable of learning complex skill sets in seconds, then subsequently forgetting them again the instant they are removed. Today, after nearly 80 years of increasingly incorporating these technologies into our daily lives, we must now ask ourselves, what comes next? In recent years, the academic community has reignited discussions on possible new methods to influence brain plasticity. Is it possible to create permanent neural pathways using coprocessors? Can we expect a breakthrough regarding dopaminergic data manipulation in our lifetimes? If so, what will be the consequences? The probable emergence of commercially viable artificial neurotransmitters would undoubtedly reshape the health science field, yet would simultaneously introduce a potentially destructive tool to most governments and corporations. The field of plasticity manipulation, remains in its infancy, but most experts agree we should prepare for a future in which neurological rewiring will become as commonplace as the cybernetic implants used so pervasively today. Studies should begin exploring now how science can adapt our bodies to optimize the effects of this technology while minimizing its abuse and potential unwanted side effects. Wow. There's almost enough to make two episodes out of, but I'm just going to call it an episode here. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.